The joint declaration signed 3 decades ago sealed Hong Kong's fate.
It's not Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong.
It's designated Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong.
Going for stability and prosperity, but always with ups and downs, twists and turns.
We still enjoy the large degree of freedom and that our way of life will remain.
咁樣寫落去咧，係應該咧係俾我哋嘅各方面嘅自由啊，同埋我哋嘅權利咧係有足夠嘅保障。
They can promise you all these things, and a few years later they could take everything back.
Good evening, welcome to the Pearl Report. I'm Diana Lin. In 1984, China and Britain signed a joint declaration to hand Hong Kong's sovereignty back to China and to allow Hong Kong people to rule the former British colony with a high degree of autonomy. This one country, two systems concept was said to be a model to reunify with Taiwan. 30 years on, Taiwan remains intransigent and mainland China seems to be reneging on its pledges to Hong Kong people. These tree-lined streets in Beijing are the capital's embassy row a century ago. The street sign says Hart Road in Austrian. Now it's known as the Taijiqiang Tao Tiao. Foreign countries used to be able to station troops and set up banks here, like a country within a country. A century later, this became the site of a Sino-British diplomatic battle to retake Hong Kong. In 1983, in Taijiqiang, China and Britain began talks on Hong Kong's future.
We didn't recognize these unequal treaties. We needed to retake Hong Kong at the right time.
Zhou Na, now retired, led the Chinese team from the 7th round of talks. He says China began making plans for Hong Kong back in 1972. The first task for China's re-entry into the UN was to wipe Hong Kong and Macau from the colonies list.
Whatever was on the list would gradually become independent. Hong Kong and Macau belonged under Chinese sovereignty. Our stance was recognized by the United Nations, meaning under international law, we'd had a legal basis to take back Hong Kong and Macau.
Seeing Hong Kong's lease was about to expire, Britain looked for ways to prolong its rule. With amicable Sino-British relations at the time, Hong Kong Governor Sir Murray McLehose, in 1978, attended his first Chinese National Day banquet in Hong Kong. The following year, Sir Murray went to Beijing to talk with Deng Xiaoping to test the prospect of extending the new territory's lease beyond 1997. Sir Murray later revealed Deng told investors not to worry, but that was only half of Deng's message. The governor did not say, Deng also stated China would retake Hong Kong in 1997.
There was that difference of principle between the two sides.
Alan Paul was a British representative in the Sino-British Joint Liaison Group.
We wanted to see if there was a way in which British administration could continue. The Chinese side were set against that.
Deng Xiaoping first proposed one country, two systems to lure Taiwan. Later, National People's Congress Chairman Ye Jianying interpreted it in a 9-point plan, which became a 12-point plan to preserve Hong Kong's capitalist system. But then British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher didn't want to hand over Hong Kong.
She said the bottom line with China was to exchange sovereignty for administration.
After winning the Falklands War, Margaret Thatcher went to China in September 1982 to meet Deng Xiaoping to discuss Hong Kong's future.
Both sides' stances were established. When Mrs. Thatcher came, she said, we see your so-called three unequal treaties as international treaties. They're valid. You can't repeal them unilaterally. For China to unilaterally announce it's taking back Hong Kong might have disastrous consequences. Deng Xiaoping's answer to these intimidating words was clear-cut. Firstly, the sovereignty question is irreversible and non-negotiable. Come 1997, if the Chinese government hadn't taken back Hong Kong, we wouldn't be worthy of ruling China. We would become the modern-day Li Hongzhang.
That the British government has a clear responsibility for the people of Hong Kong. As leader of that government, what matters to me is that we discharge our moral duty to them.
Exchanging sovereignty for administration gained the support of Hong Kong's mainstream elite. In 1983, lawmaker Alan Lee led a group to Beijing to suggest extending British governance.
We suggested the sovereignty belonged to China, but lease it to British for 30 to 50 years until the economic and social conditions and also political conditions are closer.
Martin Lee was in the group.
We pass on the message that the mention of one country, two systems casts a long shadow in Hong Kong, and Hong Kong people are worried about the future.
Because at that time, China's just over Cultural Revolution, not very long. And the people in Hong Kong, majority of them are immigrants, particularly from Shanghai, doesn't have any faith about communist rule at all.
Former head of the Hong Kong-Macau Affairs Office, Liu Ping, admitted in his memoirs Hong Kong people worried about Chinese rule. He wrote that Hong Kongers
still wanted the status quo, better not to change. About public opinion in Hong Kong at the time, to say most people positively backed Hong Kong's handover didn't fit the facts. Because in those years, our country had been in terrible chaos. Many people went through various movements. The Cultural Revolution had just passed. People were still afraid. So we never told the central government Hong Kongers supported Hong Kong's handover. We honestly relayed Hong Kongers' concerns.
China rejected the views of Alan Lee's group. The sticking point was sovereignty. Sino-British talks on Hong Kong's future formally began 10 months after Thatcher's Beijing visit. Britain persisted in retaining Hong Kong governance. Being confidential negotiations, Hong Kongers could only get snippets from the media, who in turn had to ambush negotiators on the short walk between the British embassy and residents to garner any news. The public could only infer the progress of the talks from words such as useful and constructive. In subsequent rounds, when even these words vanished, Hong Kong's confidence collapsed. The weekend of the fourth round of talks became known as Black Saturday.
People in Hong Kong know there's a problem with negotiation after the fourth round, and there's no date for the fifth round of negotiations. That is where Hong Kong people start panicking.
China then looked for intermediaries to deliver messages to Britain. Alan Lee was asked to visit Beijing again, but alone and in secret.
The person who invited me, Mr. Tong, is the director in the National Security Bureau. He gave me a very strong message. Deng Xiaoping made the decision already. If the negotiation breaks down, they will announce how to take over Hong Kong unilaterally.
The same message was delivered to London via former British Prime Minister Edward Heath, forcing Thatcher to change her strategy and prepare to retreat from Hong Kong. In January 1984, Thatcher met Hong Kong executive councillors in London and readjusted her negotiation strategies. With no hope of post-1997 governance, Britain shifted its focus. Declassified documents revealed Britain planned to use the 13 years prior to 1997 to build up a constitutional framework for Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong and introduce the elections. This was seen as the most effective way to prevent interference in the future Hong Kong SAR. China agreed that Hong Kong's chief executive should be elected or chosen via consultation, but strongly opposed elections for the Legislative Council and for the chief executive to be held accountable to LegCo. So problems persisted. Declassified material also showed only 15 days before the initialing of the joint declaration did the two sides agree to include constitutional reforms, but only in its annex. The final text of the joint declaration was close to Deng Xiaoping's concepts.
I don't think it's right to talk about one side winning or one side losing. But one of the essential points in the negotiation was the enumeration of the principles that Deng Xiaoping had set out, the 12-point plan or whatever. And that did form the nucleus, or part of the nucleus, of the joint declaration agreement as it emerged.
One task has been completed with the signing of the joint declaration. But this is not the end. The agreement on its own can't ensure a successful future for Hong Kong.
Right now, the Beijing government doesn't trust Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong, certain group of people, and neither that this group of people trusts Beijing too. But I would say that the major responsibility lies with our leaders in Beijing. They should not screening anybody out. All right? The more you control the Hong Kong people, I tell you, the more Hong Kong people doesn't trust the central government.